Class, welcome to Audio Production Techniques. This is John Barry. I'm glad you guys were able to come hang out with us tonight. So I'm really glad we had a moment there to get things set up. I actually had a little bit of technical difficulties on my end and had to do something called, I'll tell you what, I'll just go ahead and show it to you real quick. If you guys have ever done any kind of installation of any kind of application on your Mac, it's a good idea to actually use right after you're done doing an installation is to basically restart your computer and use a little bit that's in your utilities. Shift-Command-U, you can see the key at the bottom there. I'll go ahead and do that again. Shift-Command-U, you can see I've got KeyCaster running. On the Macintosh, if you're on your Finder level, that'll take you to your utilities folder. If you can't find your utilities folder or you don't remember the quick key, I'll just show you where it's located. You open up your Mac drive, and under your applications, so you can find that off to your little sidebar here, down at the very bottom, if you hit U, it'll take you all the way down to the bottom here, because it'll go alphabetical. It's inside of your utilities folder, and I'll use this little application called Disk Utility. Anytime you install anything on your Mac, anything at all, it's always a good idea to go ahead and run this afterwards. And I've got two screens running. Let me pull this over for you. And Disk Utility is basically an application that runs through and checks any of the permissions. Permissions are basically authentications for files and making sure that they have the right forks in the right directories. So generally you're just going to select your Mac hard drive, or if you've got a separate drive hooked up, you can do that as well, and just say repair disk permissions. Depending on when the last time is you did this, it may take upwards of 7 minutes to sometimes 20 or 30 minutes. But there's something that I was running into some issues earlier, so I needed to do that real quick. Also, it's nice to make sure that you guys have audio too, and I saw some of you guys had some issues getting your audio going. That's why I generally will open up a session, let it play. It also lets me know that my Pro Tools session is running really smoothly. The session that you just heard is a pretty intense session. It's actually a release that I released about a year and a half ago by a DJ, a friend of mine by the name of Icy. So this is actually something that you could actually go and purchase off of beatport.com. We'll go ahead and give myself a shameless plug right here. yeah, it's usually one of the top hits that comes up. I probably could go ahead and put in, it's my Snow Cone remix. And there you go. So yeah, feel free, if you want to check that out, you're more than welcome to. Here's the track. It's called Rick Rack. You guys actually saw the full session in motion there. And again, that's a really intense session that has a lot of virtual instruments running. Oh, wow, this is not actually, this isn't Beatport, but it's the same track. So anyways, I usually use that session just because it's a very intensive session. And it's got a lot going on inside of it. And that way I can tell right away if my Pro Tools is going to be running smoothly. So before I get started here in a moment, I'll give you guys a little brief intro about myself, and then we'll talk about the course. But before we get started, let me go ahead and just open it up for questions. Now, just be careful and understand your chat window that you guys see. It's the same very small chat window I have. So if you flood, if there's a bunch of questions that come in all at once, typically they'll scroll off screen. It'll actually be kind of difficult for me to manage seeing them all, but since it is the beginning of class, I'd like to give you guys an opportunity to get any questions you've got out of the way. And I'll generally stop throughout the class and take breaks for questions. And definitely at the end of class, I usually leave a good 15 minutes to 10 minutes to make sure I can get all of your questions in. Sometimes in the as we go throughout the class, if there's a lot of comments going on, I may miss your question. And just please understand, I'm not doing this intentionally. So if I do miss your question, just understand I will at some point pause, and definitely at the end of the class, we'll pause and make sure that we get your questions in. Course, Andy saw a lot of automation going on in that track. Yeah, there actually is a lot of automation happening. And typically, I was probably doing a lot of automation with filters. Filtering little elements in and out throughout the track. That way, it's not totally stacked up. Here, you can see several lines of automation. And that was actually a send level, probably on a delay that I was throwing a small delay on. And yeah, a lot of other little spots like that. So, if this looks all foreign to you right now, that's okay. It should look a little bit foreign. And we will get into automation. Automation will be reserved for typically the third or fourth week. But we'll get into that because it's one of the cooler features inside of Pro Tools. Michael actually asks here, will we be discussing recording techniques such as mic placement, etc.? Or no, that's really not this class. This class, you're basically going to be focusing on performing a remix. We're going to take you through, we're going to give you guys some materials to use for a remix, and we're going to show you how a remix is implemented in Pro Tools. Basically, it's the entire course deals with Pro Tools, nothing but Pro Tools. You will not use any other applications other than something like KeyCaster, which you can see just displays my key commands. So KeyCaster is used, and it's really only so you guys can see what it is I'm doing. That way, if I'm going a little fast, I'm not leaving you behind. Charles asked a really good question, and this is kind of an important one. Pro Tools 11.0.3 is actually the most current version. However, I want you guys to please don't use Pro Tools 11. You want to actually use version 10.3.7. So, yeah, Pro Tools 11 is out there, so that's probably the most current version. However, there's still some bugs with it. It's a brand new application. It's only been around for a little while. I believe it was introduced in May of this year. But there's still kind of some quirks here and there. One of the main quirks is that the plugin format has changed. It's a complete rewrite. Pro Tools 11 and Pro Tools 10 are completely different in the rewrite. They work pretty much exactly the same. They look almost identical. So you won't really see a really big difference. And in fact, I have both of them installed on this machine. You can see here's my version 10.3.7, which is what we're using in this class. So I want you guys to actually use that version. So if you're using version 11 and you don't have this, go ahead and download and use this. I've got a link here for you. Let's find the latest version for you. I keep little notes off the side. That way, if you guys need this kind of information, I don't know if this is actually going to paste with my link there. Yeah, hang on one second. I'm actually going to have to use my link, and this will allow me to give you guys the same link. So, in the event that you have some other version of Pro Tools, make sure you go ahead and do this upgrade process immediately. You don't need to do it during our class this evening, but you'll definitely want to take care of this because this is going to make sure that you guys have the latest and greatest version, and the version that's going to be basically the most stable. So, we want to make sure that you guys have a stable working system, and this is going to be it. I'll go ahead and give you guys, for those of you that do already have 11 installed, you'll still want to go back and install Pro Tools 10.3.7. But in the event that you have 11 installed, let me go ahead and give you the latest update for that as well. Give you guys the link. Let's see here. Give me one moment, and that way you guys will have this information. But yeah, good questions. Those are perfect. Nilly, yeah, there was actually a post that went out that was a pretty big deal on the FSO message board, letting you guys know to please do not install Mavericks. So if you've already installed it, you may run smoothly, but you may not. I couldn't actually tell you whether it's going to work perfectly or not because I've refrained from installing it. And there's multiple reasons why. And it's okay if you install it. This is a good time to learn this lesson. It's better to learn it in school than be out in the field and learn it. Anytime you have a project that you know you're going to be working on, or you know you've got to get work done, stay away from installing the latest and greatest of anything. I don't care what it is. We've all heard that old adage of it ain't broke, don't fix it. Well, there's a reason for that, especially when you're working in a computer environment. If you're working on a project and you go ahead and you do some update and it renders your machine to be unstable, then And yeah, you're going to maybe potentially miss out on work or lose that client. So while you're here in school, it's not probably as painful a lesson to learn. But okay, cool. Yeah, it looks like you just missed that post. Not a big deal. It could run perfectly, Nilly. I couldn't tell you. I've refrained from installing it, so you may not run into any issues. I do know that Pro Tools, I believe 11.0.3 is qualified for Mavericks, but there again, I've refrained from installing it just because I've got to teach you guys, and I got to make sure that I've got a stable machine. So anytime I'm working on a project of any kind or any scope, I don't care if it's even something for my own personal use, I refrain from doing any kind of installations till I've done a bunch of research and made sure that the install that I'm installing isn't going to render my machine to be an unhappy machine. So if you're running smooth, great. Awesome. I'm glad to hear it. If not, you'll probably need to, if for some reason, Nilly, you run into an issue, you'll probably need to contact FSO support and figure out how you're going to get back down to an earlier version. Hopefully, you've got something like Time Machine. That way, you could quickly and easily get back to your older OS. But that would be something that would be actually outside of anything I would be able to help you with. You basically need to contact FSO support. But if you're running smooth, no harm, no sweat, then don't worry about it. Nilly says, okay, great. Awesome. Great. Any other questions? One quick note about your books. It's typical for students to let me know, hey, I haven't got my book. Where's my book? You guys all should have received an email from McGraw-Hill, so you'll need to check your full sale email. And that email will give you guys links to open up your VitalSource book. I don't think Pro Tools 11 book has been written yet, but it's Pro Tools 10 Ignite. And quite honestly, even if you had an older version of the book, I'm talking like 9 or 10, it really hasn't changed very much. And there are some slight changes in 11, but they aren't drastic enough that you would actually warrant needing a brand new book. So you should have gotten that email. It'll give you the codes and allow you guys to download a PDF version into your VitalSource, which is basically a secure way of procuring your book. So in the event that you haven't got that email, make sure you go and check your full sale email first. But while I'd love to help you with it, that'll be something you'd actually have to contact FSO support as well. And it's not because I'm trying to defer you guys off or I don't want your emails. It's really having to do with I don't do the book distribution. They actually deal with the book distribution. And David Brown, you said you've got the wrong redemption code. Please go ahead and contact FSO support. They'll be able to get you sorted out. I think they actually have you fill out some kind of ticket that gives them specifics about your situation and your exactly what's going on, and then they'll be able to work that out for you. Again, I'd love to be able to help you with it, but unfortunately, I don't have anything to do with just distribution. So if you contact me, I'm going to end up asking you to please contact FSO support. Okay, cool. Yeah. Michael Barker says that he had to contact VitalSource with something to do with that code and they fixed it. Again, I wish I knew the process on this. You may just want to contact VitalSource first, but I think FSO support may be your first point of contact. I really couldn't tell you because it's not something that I have to deal with a whole bunch, but I do know that FSO support will be able to direct you guys and everything latest and greatest and get you guys up and running with your book. So we've got somewhat of a short week this week. We've got Turkey Day coming up, so happy Thanksgiving to everybody. This will be the only time that we'll have a live stream session, at least dealing with your project that I'll be doing. Brad Barbie will be giving a live stream session tomorrow evening, but it'll have to do with an assignment that normally would be turned in on Sunday. But we've realized and want to recognize the holiday for you guys and allow you guys to spend time with your friends and family and get the much needed rest that you probably are well deserved of. So I've bumped those assignments back. They've been bumped back 2 extra days, so you won't actually have to turn the assignment in until Tuesday night. And that's because, again, I want you guys to spend time with your friends and family. Stuff your faces as much as you can with all the great food and come back and get yourself back involved in your scholastics. So just understand that your assignments that normally would be due on, normally there'd be a test every single Friday. It's a multiple choice test. We bumped it back. Normally that's on Friday. I went ahead and bumped that back till Tuesday as well. And then normally every Sunday you'll have a video screen capture assignment that's detailed, and you guys will be able to see everything that you need to know about it. Tomorrow night's live stream session really deals with the screen capture that will be due basically a week from tomorrow. And in the event that you can't make any of our live stream sessions, we archive them and they are located in your announcements tab. So I'm glad you guys were able to come spend time with me tonight. But in the event that you're not able to, don't worry, you're not going to miss out on this information. We always archive them and we have a link available for you. It usually takes about 24 hours to get the link posted. So when we're done here this evening, I'll start rendering it immediately. That way I can try to get it up sooner than that. But sometimes it does take a couple times to try to render those files down to get them onto a medium so that you guys can watch the archives. So in the event you miss it, that's not a big deal. It'll be there for you. You won't miss it out on any information. So let's see. We've covered the book. We got that out of the way. We've talked about this week and dealing with the holidays. Yippee! Awesome. A little break. We've discussed your upcoming assignments, and they've all been pushed back. Yeah, Michael, go ahead. You have a question. I'm not sure what you mean about Thursday class assignment because your Thursday class assignment should have been pushed till tomorrow. So we've actually bumped that earlier. And again, remember that's just going over an assignment that's not actually due for a full week. Oh, wow. Okay. I'll have to go back and take a look at that. That's odd. In fact, let me see if I can take care of that while we're here right now. Hey Michael, do you happen to know what section you are assigned to? If not, it's not a big deal. I can find it. Yeah, EPO is good to go, but I'm just trying to figure out what section you'll be in. And if you don't know, again, I can check real quick. So I'm kind of allowing you guys to see the back end of how FSO works. It's kind of interesting. Yeah, I had some quirkiness last night in getting your class set up. Let's see. I don't see anything here that says October, so it must not be this section. You said you're in section one? I was just checking section one. Oh, okay. Yeah, if it's just the text inside of the assignment, that looks like something that should have just been nailed down. Typically, that's something that Brad takes care of because that's his class. So it looks like he's just missed the details on that. So basically, the assignment that you're asking about, if I go and take a look at my preview here, this will allow me to see it like you guys see it. Okay, yeah, this is just a small detail that I'll make sure I mention to Brad. Brad, it's basically his class, so I'll just make sure he knows that he needs to go back and change that date. And you can see that obviously that date's incorrect. The information for the class won't be, but you can see it obviously is a class that happens tomorrow. Okay, yeah, cool. Thank you for bringing that to my attention, though. Anytime you see any kind of small typo like that, I'd much rather know about it than not know about it. And it's just an easy fix. When we're done with class tonight, I'll fire off an email to Brad. I just want to make sure the reason I was kind of actually freaking out is because information you probably don't even need to know, but that long list of all the dates that you saw when I went to post your classes up. Episode changed every single date on every single assignment, and I had to go back for each and every section and change the begin date, the end date on every single assignment. And I was just concerned because I was up till 6 in the morning last night doing that, so I thought maybe it was something I had overlooked. So I appreciate you bringing my attention to that. Thank you. Yeah, it may not let you register because Brad has to go back and actually change not just on FSO, but he also has to change within the GoTo training. He's got to update that link. And that's something that I typically let him take care of simply because he teaches the class for that particular live stream. So, again, I appreciate you bringing my attention to that. I'll fire off an email to him once we're done with class tonight. And again, anytime you see any kind of small discrepancy like that, I'd much rather know about it than to not know about it. Cool. Any other questions or concerns? So let me start off by just giving you guys just a kind of a quick introduction about me, and then I want to jump into our materials only because I really want to jump in and show you guys what we're going to be doing. Just to give you kind of a background. I started playing clarinet, and well, let me step back a little bit further. I was actually really fortunate as a kid because I was raised in a musical family. My father played bass with Nat King Cole, Wayne Newton, Kenny Rogers, Willie Nelson. He was a traveling musician as well as a session musician, and so I had the privilege of showing up at nightclubs and, swanky little joints as a kid, watching my dad perform on stage. And obviously, staying up way later than my bedtime and drinking Shirley Temples with adults. And a Shirley Temple, by the way, is a non-alcoholic drink. It's basically Sprite and grenadine with a little cherry on it. But I felt pretty privileged as a kid, and it really influenced what I was going to do later in my life. I played clarinet at the age of 6th grade. What was that? Maybe, I don't know, 12 or 13. Didn't really like the clarinet too much. I didn't think it was a really hip instrument. Guitars were the rage back then, and as were synthesizers. They were starting to really make a big impact into the 80s. And I ditched the clarinet and really didn't take up music again until right about when I graduated high school and I started DJing. And I got some really cool DJ gigs that basically gave me residencies. So every Friday and Saturday night, I'd find myself in a club playing dance records. And when I say dance records, we're really back then talking about things like Front 242, Netzer Ebb, Depeche Mode, The Cure. So I was into this really alternative dance music style, and I was hearing sounds that I didn't know how they were created. I'm listening to Nine Inch Nails, and I'm trying to figure out, well, how were these sounds created? So I started searching out synthesizers and picking up magazines that dealt with electronic music recording and mixers and outboard effects processors, and started actually buying this gear on my own as well. And before I'd known it, I'd really amassed a really cool little hip studio with several different synthesizers. I've owned over 300 different synthesizers in my lifetime. And at one point, I had a really substantial room with, oh geez, I don't know, over 50 synths wrapped around in this really, really cool little environment with a mixer and outboard effects unit and racks of gear. And I found myself really involved in dance music. And at that time, dance music was really starting to change because computers were getting fast enough to where a lot of these things you didn't really have to have the physical piece of gear any longer. You could start to do it inside of a computer. And I'm talking, this is pre-virtual instruments. We're just talking about some of the beginnings of plugins. So I really saw the writing on the wall pretty quickly, and I realized that this is something that I wanted to get involved in. One of the first records I ever worked on was a record by this group called Boys and Girls United. And the way that came about was it's basically a small pop group. It was two guys, two girls, and hence the name Boys and Girls United. The way that came about is I had all these synths, and one of my buddies was managing a facility. here in Orlando called WEG, Wright Entertainment Group. And if you look up WEG, WEG is responsible for NSYNC, Britney Spears, Justin Timberlake. In fact, he's still under the WEG management label as far as his management goes. So they would have all these side projects that they would have going on. And a buddy of mine said, hey, let's do one of their records out of your place. You've got all these synths. And at the time, their studio consisted of a really large SSL and a lot of nice outboard gear, but not a whole lot of synthesizers. They were hiring out producers to do that. So we ended up doing a lot of that, at least that track, out of my house. It was a really cool experience. The track actually hit the Billboard Top 40 dance chart. Didn't actually hit the Top 40. There's a Top 40 and there's a Top 40 dance chart. But either way, it was really cool to garner that attention. And that kind of forged my way into what I do today. So that kind of gives you an insight. I really come from a dance background. I've done reggae, ska, hip-hop, punk, rock. I've done a lot of different genres, but I primarily stay within the underground dance music circuit. And I don't DJ out quite as much anymore. I just don't have the time to dedicate to it between teaching full-time and carrying a relationship and also producing here and there. I just don't have the time to have the residencies to DJ out quite as much, but it's basically where I got my start. So that gives you kind of an insight as to where I came from. So what I want to do is actually share with you guys how we're going to end up doing this in Pro Tools. So understand that everything we're going to do this month is going to be dealing with Pro Tools. So first of all, I want you guys to take a look at the Avid website. I'll go ahead and give you guys this link here. And I want to show you guys some resources that you may not even realize you have. So the resources I'm talking about is if we go ahead and you log into your account. Now, remember, your account should actually be tied to your full sale email address. If it's not, you're going to need to contact FSO support, and they'll have to get that sorted out for you because they'll have to get it ported over. Anytime we have any updates or anything like that, you guys typically get some special consideration that other people don't get. So you want to make sure that your account is tied to your full sale account. Mine obviously is not, but I've been teaching Pro Tools and dealing with Pro Tools since 1997. So there you go. It's been dealing with it for a while. So here I'm actually going to show you. You've got some loops, over 8.5 gigs worth of loop libraries that I'm going to be using here. And I want you guys to realize that everything that I'm going to use, you're going to have the same assets as well. So if you go, once you log in, you want to go to My Products, and you want to go to View My Product Details. And under View My Product Details, you'll see anything that you've purchased or were given via the Launchbox platform. So here you might see a couple new things that you may not have in your Launchbox, but they're things that I've purchased throughout the years. Under your download section for whatever version of Pro Tools, here's where you're going to find those loops. Down at the bottom here, you can see any of these loops that say Big Fish. You can download these. If you're going to download them, be sure you download them one at a time. If not, you're going to run into some issues. You're going to run into some issues with, I've had it happen myself where if I try to download multiple of these, that you'll get some kind of weird errant message. So you'll need to download these one at a time. You can also find these loops on your installation disks, and that's probably a lot faster way of getting them. And it's, I believe it's called Avid Sounds and Samples or something along those lines. Nilly, so if you'll need to contact FSO support if your account's under your email address, because you need to get that ported over to your full sale address. And again, it's basically because you guys get special considerations whenever it comes to updates. So Pro Tools 11 just launched, so I don't see this happening anytime soon. But if they come out with Pro Tools 11, typically that would be something that you'd have to pay for. And as long as it's tied to your full sale address, they're going to give you guys some special considerations and things like that. So yeah, you'll want to contact FSO support to be sure that you get that ported over. So be sure you download these loops because you're going to see me use these throughout our sessions here. And what we are going to be dealing with every single Monday night is we're going to be dealing with your final project. So I know you guys, you typically would probably wait to start on your final project. It's not due to the very last day of week 4, but I don't want you to do that, because if you do, you're going to kind of paint yourself in a corner, because we're going to be racing ahead of you working on this every single week. So here are some assets that you can use in your remix. And then I want to show you another resource that I want you to use that you're going to get some stem files from a popular artist. And that is from indabamusic.com. So I'm going to go ahead and give that link to you guys now as well. And this is a really cool website because this website will actually allow you to enter into contest opportunities to win money and get some recognition as well as being put on the artist's single and or album. So if you go to indabamusic.com, you want to go up to where it says opportunities. And you can see I've already created an account here. This is a free account. In the free account, they'll give you three different artists' opportunities. They basically call them a key. So you'll have to use a key to unlock one of the opportunities, but it is free. They give you three different artists that you can choose from. Once you absorb your three free opportunities, you would, I think you'd have to actually pay for it if you want to get more activation out of it. I actually happen to have a paid account. I thought it should have actually, my paid account should have run up, but maybe it's been billing my credit card and I just haven't been paying attention. But I just want you guys to realize that you will have three different artists unless you pay for the account, and I don't want you to pay for the account. The pro account is typically $50 a year. Sometimes they will give you, sometimes usually around Christmas or right after Christmas, they'll give you some deals where you can get it for like half off or like $25. But you don't actually have to have a paid account. You can actually use a free account. So once you log into your account, and in this case, you don't have to use your full sale email address. You can use whatever email address you want. But I've chosen to use my Gmail account. So once you log into your free account, you want to go up to your Opportunities tab. And here in the Opportunities tab, they're going to show you what available artists are here for you to remix. So you can see I'm actually, this is a little banner, and I like to just scroll down a little bit. Because if you scroll down, you'll be able to see what it is that are available to us. Like, for instance, this one right here gives you $1,000. So I haven't even listened to this. We're going to listen to it in a moment. And you want to make sure it says remix because you'll need to get the actual files. And we're going to show you how to do that this evening. Here's another one, The Hives. So it says remix The Hives, come on, to win prizes including a release on Xbox Music plus $2,500. And a Surface Pro 2, and also some more. Here we have remixed the Hush Sounds Scavengers to win gear from Diodario, Planet Waves, Korg, and more. So what we're going to do is we're actually going to go pretend as though we're going to get these files tonight. First, what I want to do is, since you guys only have three opportunities, it's going to be really wise for you to listen to these before you just start downloading them, because what if it's a song that you're not interested in at all? Or it just doesn't fit a genre that you're not into. So let's go back and let's try listening to one of these. Let's start off with ZZ Ward's single, 365 Days. So you click on ZZ Ward. You can see it's going to open up a page. It might take a little bit on my end. There we go. And then I'm going to want to go ahead and listen to this song before we actually start remixing it. So I'm going to go ahead and listen to it. It has a little player here. You just hit the play icon and let's take a listen. Your clothes out on the black. And I tell you what, mine is currently playing out of my Mac, and let's listen to it together out loud for a second. So I just need to change something in my AMS. I'm actually playing out of a Duet, so we'll change my built-in audio to play out of that, and let's try that again. Your clothes out on the blacktop, scattered suits on the street, frames and broken pictures in mid-September heat. We say these nights on fire, so hot, we bend it down. Now all that's left of us is ashes on the ground. I told you back in June, you knew damn well what I would do. 365 Cool, nice little pop track. I could go through it and I could skim through the song as well. The little player at the bottom allows you to drop wherever you like to play back from. I thought it was pretty cool. I'm really concerned actually with the tempo of this, and we can actually find out that information as well. I think this might not be too bad for hip hop, but let's actually take a look. They'll give us information about the song. Where you want to get that information is over here. It says FAQ, which stands for Frequently Asked Questions. So if we take a look here, It says, let's see. Here we go. 365 days in the key of C sharp minor at 90 beats per minute. So sure enough, yeah, that's typically a good hip hop beat, and so that might not be a bad hip hop remix. So if I'm looking to do something that might be hip hop influenced, but maybe give it more of a pop vibe with some nice female vocals over top of it, there you go. Knock yourself out. Let's go back and let's listen to one of the other songs. And one of these, I'm going to go ahead and we're going to pick it and we're going to choose it. And I'm going to download the files. We're going to show you how to get the files into Pro Tools. By the way, the individual files are right here. Notice here, if I wanted to adjust some of the drums, here are the drums. We could download just the drums. I'm not going to do that just yet. I'll go ahead and play back the drums for a second so you can hear that it's just the drums by themselves. That way you've got the individual parts so that you can go into a remix. So have you ever wondered, well, how do I get just the vocals out of a song? You really can't get just the vocals out of the song. You have to have the artist give you the stems. So here we'll listen to the drums, and if you want, maybe we'll listen to the lead vocals here for a second. So we'll give the raw drums a try just for a second. All right, cool. And you can see the player actually shows you the raw drums there. Let's try the lead vocals here real quick. And I'm going to drop it in where we got some nice vocals.
Your clothes out on the blacktop, scattered suits on the street, frames and broken pictures in mid-September heat. We say these nights on fire so hot, we've been.
All right, you get the idea. It's the individual stems. That way you can actually go and put your own magic touch on it. All right, cool. So we've got an idea at least what stems are all about. And we're going to get you guys started here in a moment with working on your remix. Let's go back to the opportunities page. Let's scroll down. Let's take a listen to the highs. So here the highs page is going to open up here in a moment. Let's scroll down and audition their song and see what it sounds like. Get an idea if this might be something we'd be interested in doing or not. Let's take a listen. Nice track, really cool, in more of the punk rock vein. Now, something I would be concerned about with this right away is I'm hearing the tempo is really up there. I think we're pushing beyond 140, probably more around the 145 range. So again, it's something you have to think about when you're trying the remix. You've got to understand that you're going to be dealing with the original artist's tempo. You could speed it up or slow it down, but typically you might want to just stick with what they have and see if you can work around that. I know that's probably, it could work out as a hip hop track. However, I would probably have to figure out their tempo and then half my tempo in order to work that out. So if we scroll down and take a look here, under frequently asked questions, let's take a look. We'll scroll down, it tells us here. All right, wow, yeah, it's definitely up there. So come on, it's in the key of C sharp minor. Wow, that's funny. And wasn't that what our last song was in? Yeah, it was. And here, look at that, 186 beats per minute. So now here, check this out. Here's the bigger piece of information that you want to pay attention to. It says it's no click. The reason it says it's no click is that means the tempo does not stay at a consistent 186 beats per minute. That's going to be a real pain in the butt to use inside of your DAW because really what's happening is there's not one set tempo. The tempo is going to fluctuate throughout the song. So getting that to lock up to your grid and your DAW, that's going to be a difficult challenge. In fact, I didn't even pay attention if our last song said that or not. Let's take a look. I don't think it did, but I want to go back and actually pay attention to that because that's actually going to be a big deal. Now, are there ways of getting around that? Yeah, I could go and map it out. Yeah, it just says it's straight up 90 beats per minute, so no problems there. There are ways of getting around that. However, I don't want you guys to paint yourself into a corner. So if I were to try and sway you, I would tell you probably stay away from that. Otherwise, you and I are going to have to spend some one-on-one time trying to figure out the way that tempo is going to work. Basically, there is an answer for it. It would be doing identify beat to every single bar throughout the song to figure out the tempo. We could also use Beat Detective. However, these are more advanced topics that we're actually going to save for future courses. Let's take a look at our other option here. This is The Hush, and the song is called Scavengers. Let's take a listen real quick, see what we got, see if it's something we'd be interested in. So again, if I were you, I would stay away from the Hives track. If you are dying to do it and you have to do it, just understand you have now chosen a very difficult song to do, and you're going to be graded on this. Could I spend an hour and a half with you and help you out with it? Yeah, of course I could. But it really would probably wouldn't be feasible for me to spend an hour and a half with every single one of my students. Not that I wouldn't want to, but you understand the challenge there. That would be pretty difficult. Let's take a look at the Hush Sound Scavengers and listen to their track. So cool track. Female vocalist reminds me of Deborah Harry. Very cool track. I'm gonna have some concerns with that one as well. The reason why is we're listening to basically a rock act, and a rock act doesn't necessarily follow a click track. So if we go down and we look at their frequently asked questions, we take a look at tempo. I have a feeling this one's not gonna be recorded to click either. I'll explain more about that as well. So a rock band, typically you're gonna be dealing with a live drummer. A live drummer is actually going to push and pull on the drums throughout certain sections of the song. During the verses, he's going to slow down typically to allow you to understand the story about what happened. And during the chorus section, he's going to pick up the tempo slightly to push along the song to let you know that the angst or the crux or the point of what the whole song is about. Whereas the verses are going to lay back slightly, that way you can get in the storyline and explain what's happening and why the importance of the actual course itself. So let's take a look at frequently asked questions and let's take a look. Yep, nailed it. Okay, it's in the key of E major at around 168 beats per minute and again with no click. So if I were to try to tell you which song to go for, I would not go for any of the songs except for a ZZ song. So that kind of limits your availability to what you could actually use for this month. So let me open this up and give you some other opportunities that you may not actually find here on Indaba. One of those is going to be Beatport. And Beatport is typically reserved for DJs, but there's also some opportunities to remix on their side as well. Now, if you're not familiar with Beatport, think of Beatport as being basically like where DJs go to buy their music as opposed to iTunes. The reason for this is that iTunes doesn't necessarily cater to independent labels quite as well. And a lot of the dance styles that you'll hear, especially with things like dubstep or your trance or any of the breakbeat styles, you're going to find those basically on Beatport. You're not going to find them, typically not going to find them on iTunes. Plus, iTunes does not give you raw WAV files. So if we go to Beatport Play, Beatport Play is going to show you here. I'll give you guys this link. So you guys have this link as well. Okay, so let's see. Open for submissions. And you can see down at the bottom, similar to like what our Indaba site had, you've got some options here for what you actually want to remix. That could be cool. Timo Maas is a pretty well-known artist. So let's take a look here. All of these guys here, if you go up to view also, it says open for submissions. This is where you want to actually take a look. So we'll go to view all, and we'll see what we got here. Oh, Tegan and Sarah tracks too. Wow, there might be some cool stuff in here. All right, we'll start off here at the top, and we're just going to go down, and we're just going to browse these guys real quick. I don't want to spend too much time in here, but it looks like we got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 different artists to choose from. Now, typically these tracks, they're not going to be laid out in the typical intro, verse, verse, chorus, verse, chorus, bridge fashion. So it'd be a good idea to go back and listen to this, because that's going to be something important that we're going to be dealing with this month. So if we listen to, we'll listen to here, Dank, Wonder Child. You click on the artist, you can see here it gives you the original track. So down at the bottom here, I'm going to go ahead and play this original track. And I think this is a free account too. I've got my own account. I'm obviously not logged in. But you can see it allows you to download the parts. I'm not even logged in. Let's go ahead and listen to it and see what it sounds like. Yeah, cool. Big epic track, really in your face kind of sounds, but I'm noticing there's not really any set vocals going for us. So you're more than welcome to pick something like that. Just understand that setting out your sections for what's a verse and what's a chorus won't be as defined. Let's go back and listen to another artist here. Tiga versus Audion. I have a feeling we might have some vocals in this track. Let's just give it a shot and see what it sounds like. So go ahead and play the original track. So again, you can hear it's a little bit more tracky. We're not hearing set big vocal parts going on. And actually, I've heard some really large DJs playing this track out already. And the line in this is, let's go dancing. I want to go dancing with you all night long. You could hear this being played at Electric Daisy Carnival. But again, it's more track-based. We're not really looking at the huge pop construction. So let's go back and see if we've got something else that'll give us more of a pop. How about this Tegan and Sarah, Closer? Now, nothing wrong with these tracks that we're listening to, but I'm just trying to let you know that you're going to have a hard time figuring out where parts go if it's not really obvious. In other words, it's going to sound really track-based where things are just kind of happening randomly, or even vocal stabs are happening here and there, but maybe not the full vocal is going on in the track. Let's take a listen to Tegan and Sarah. Thank you. All right, cool. I actually like that because you can hear, obviously, we have the standard sections happening in the song. So laying out the format of the song will be really easy in figuring out where parts should go. So this is not a bad option. I really like the song for a song choice. Let's see what else we have. Two more to listen to, Groove Armada, and then we'll go on with Timo Maas. Let's try Groove Armada. I think this one's been up for a while, but let's take a listen. You get it. Still kind of track based. We got some vocal snippets in there. The vocal snippets keep it interesting, but at the same respect, it's something that just not my own personal preference. If it's something you are interested in working on, go for it. Knock yourself out. Let's go back and listen to Timo Maas real quick. And then I have one last other resource. This next resource, I'm not going to actually go through and listen to each song because it's a very large resource, but this is very typical during the holidays. Most of the music industry nearly shuts down. Most of the entertainers go back to visit with their family. So you'll find that not only do some of these contests get a little bit sparse, but actually the releasing of music typically through December and January will get kind of slowed down. The actual entire market, the industry slows down slightly. Let's take a listen to Timo Maas. I actually really like that. I think that's pretty cool. It's got kind of a steampunk attitude, little dance track to it where you're mixing in a couple styles here. We've almost got punk music happening with a dance track. So it's like punk rock meets electronica. I'm going to go ahead and download these parts. And while this is downloading, let's see here. Okay, let's go ahead and let me log myself in real quick. Hopefully this is my login. It's been a while since I've logged into Beatport. All right, excellent. So that part is now downloading in the background. Looks like that's going to take quite a while because it's 706 megabytes. And while I'm streaming to you guys, the streaming is taking up quite a bit of bandwidth. So I'm streaming and downloading at the same time. That's going to take a little while. We're going to let that ride for a bit. I may actually go back and download another item as well. So let me give you guys one other resource. And this is a resource I've actually held off on sharing this for quite a while. And the reason for that is there's a lot of stuff on here. And I'm not even going to take the time to actually go through and listen to it. I'm just going to give you guys this asset. And if you want it, knock yourself out with it. This is actually an asset by it's called Mixing Secrets for the Small Studio. It gives you additional resources. And they actually have some disclaimers in here, but you can see here. You can go and listen, but they give you, if you want the full multi-track, some of these are going to be MP3s, some of these are going to be WAV files. You get to actually choose pretty much, I think, what you want. I typically like to get the full WAV file. I don't like dealing with MP3s because WAV files sound superiorly better, and I want to have full fidelity. I don't want someone already stepping on my sound. So, but here's a lot of options here for you. I thought some of these gave you WAV file options, maybe not. But you can see there's all kinds of stuff here for you guys to choose. Now, be careful when you're choosing this stuff. If you go find a rock act, understand a lot of times a rock act is going to have some swing to them. So again, they're going to speed up or slow down, and they may or may not have been recording to a click track. If they're not recording to a click track, you're going to have a really hard time doing what I'm about to show you how to do inside of Pro Tools. So since that other file is taking so long to download, let's go and take a look at the length of the download here. Yeah, we may actually not actually have time to get this downloaded. So what I want to show you guys is what your next step would be for this week. And it's not really asking a lot. It's really showing you guys how to get the files over into Pro Tools and then what you should do with the files once you've got them into Pro Tools. Again, this looks like it might take too long for us to actually get this on board for tonight. So let me go back to something that I already know I have. And in this case, there's another cool lesson to learn in this. And notice here that they didn't give us the tempo information. So what I'm about to show you is how to get that kind of information. This is very typical for an artist that you're working with to say, yeah, great, I want you to do a remix. Here's my files. And maybe email them back, say, hey, what key is it in and what tempo? And they're like, oh, I don't know, man. Just there's the files. Go with it. Do your thing. And that's actually very, very typical. Many times the artist is not very technically savvy or maybe even musically inclined to know that kind of information. And it's going to be up to you to figure that out. So what I want to do is I want to use some files that I already have downloaded and I've already added in the information. Remember back when we were looking at Indaba. Indaba gave us some information that we really liked. It gave us the key of the song. It also gave us the tempo. While that's all well and good, when you go to download these files from Indaba, in fact, I'm going to go grab that one artist. Since we already have my download manager clogged up, we're going to clog it up a little bit further with something else that's downloading in the background. And I'm going to move forward and show you guys what you should be doing with these files. So let's go back to the opportunities. Remember, I like that ZZ song, which was one of the first ones we're going to find right up top here. I'm noticing that you guys are having quite a bit of lag on your end, and I apologize for that. That really has to do with the fact that I'm now downloading and trying to transmit to you guys at the same time. Okay, there we go. You're starting to see your screens now. Just so you guys are aware, I actually have a second computer set up that I'm actually monitoring to see what it is that you guys are seeing. So not only do I have my own system going on here where I'm broadcasting to you, but I also have a system that's receiving so I can see what it is that you guys see as well. So if we go to ZZ's, let's show you this process too, because this is kind of important, okay? The bit of information that we saw about the actual tempo and key, you're going to want to actually add that to your file. That way you have that for later. Let's say that you download a couple of these songs and you don't end up using this song. Well, at some point when this contest ends, you can't get the files any longer, so then you won't have the information about the files either. Let's go ahead and download all these stems. You could download individual parts, but there's no sense in that. Let's go ahead and download all the stems. Of course, it wants me to log in. Let me see here. I'm trying to remember which account I used. Let's try this. Okay. So here you've got the typical accept and continue. They're basically just saying here, this is a lot of jargon here. It's basically saying this is not your property. Even though they're giving you the raw files for this artist's work, you don't own these files. So if you try to go and resell this in any way, they're going to come back and sue the living daylights out of you. So I just saved you about 20 minutes worth of reading, only to figure out that you don't own these files. Don't do anything illegal with them. Don't try to sell them or pass them off as your work. This is not your work. We'll go ahead and accept and continue. And the download process will begin. Cool. We can see the downloads now started. Now, I'm going to go ahead and show that we got the download going. Coolio. Now, when this downloads, take a look at the download name. It says premium because I have a premium account. It has everything in lowercase, has all these underscores and dashes, has extra little information at the end that we don't need, some weird objective number that means nothing to me. When I'm done downloading that file, I'm going to then add to that file. I'm going to go back and actually change. I'm getting rid of the premium. I'm going to make ZZ capitalized, the W in Word capitalized, because that's typically the way artists would present their work. And that way I've got it nice and archived well. But I'm also going to go back and in that file, I'm going to add in this extra information that we saw under FAQ, frequently asked questions. In other words, I'm going to add in the tempo information. We saw it down here at the bottom, 90 beats per minute, as well as the key signature. That way, if 6 months from now I decide, hey, I want to work on this and try to send it to the artist, or I want to work on this and do my own small little mash that I would never sell, but maybe I might potentially play it out when I DJ, then I would have that information. Okay? So just understand that that's kind of some inf key information that you're. Get it? Key information? All right. It's the information you're going to want to add to the file at some point. Now let's go and show you how you want to get these files into Pro Tools. We'll go ahead and hide Safari for right now. And I don't need AMS to be viewing anymore. You can quit out of that. You can hide some of my notes that I had. Let's go ahead and let's start off with a brand new Pro Tools session. So I'll close the existing session that I have. We don't have to worry about saving it. And let's create a brand new session. Now, for today's lesson, I'm actually going to create a brand new session and I'm actually going to save it back to my desktop. Me slide this out of the way slightly here. So we're going to go up to File, New, where you can see the quickie would be Command N. And in our new session dialog, you have some options here. You have basically, they're asking you, well, what audio file type? You want to stick with broadcast wave, not AIF. You can tell me why. And I haven't really covered this, so if you don't know why, it's okay. But it's a good lesson to learn because this is basically the standard audio file format that you want to use whenever you're doing any kind of work. I don't care whether it's a Mac or whether it's in Logic or Pro Tools, you actually want to stick with broadcast wave or wave. So it's pretty much the same thing. Any guesses as to why that would be? This is a question for the class. No takers on that one, huh? Well, I'll go ahead and tell you why. The reason why, yeah, it works for most DAWs, but there's a reason why, Corey. I'm glad you said that, but there's a reason why. Yeah, it has to do with compatibility. It's Mac and PC compatible. All right, AIFF is not, it's only compatible with a Macintosh. So if we're talking about you're going to share this with a buddy of yours, and you guys are going to try to collaborate together, and he's on a PC and you're on a Mac, well, if you saved everything as AIFF, he's going to look at you and be like, what do I do with these files? I can't do anything with these. These will only work on a Mac. So get used to using Broadcast Wave. Your bit depth, stay away from 16-bit, even if the files are already 16-bit, which I know the files we're going to import are. I'm going to go ahead and make them 24 or 32-bit, and my files will have to convert to be that bit depth. I could change the sample rate, quite honestly, but I'm going to stick with 44.1. I/O settings, it's really dealing with input and output settings. We're going to leave that for stereo mixed. We'll go ahead and we'll hit OK. Now, before I do this, let me show you what I typically had done. I'm skipping over parts here. But whenever you have these files, once they're finally downloaded, let me show you my hierarchy here. Inside my music folder, I have an artist remix files. That's where I'm going to store these files that we just downloaded from Indaba or Beatport Play. I have a Pro Tools. So in other words, here's all the little files that you'll find from the different artists that I've either worked with or stuff we've downloaded. Cool. Here are my Pro Tools sessions, totally different from my artists. Cool. So this is where I'm going to save my sessions. And then I also have a sample library down here, Sounds and Samples. And here you can see Avid Materials. That's a folder I created, and there's all those files that I asked you to download, the assets. 8.5 gigs worth of free loop libraries that I want you guys to download. So I'm going to go back, and just as an example, we're going to use, under my artist remix files, I have a pretty cool song here by Christina Aguilera. So I'm going to go ahead and copy just the name of basically her name and the name of the song. Now notice I did what I explained to you guys that I always do. I put into the file, you can see here, I put into the file the actual BPM or beats per minute, it's 103 beats per minute, and I also, it's in an A flat. Now the reason you saw me copy the name is I'm going to use that whenever we go to save this. So I'm going to save it back to my desktop for right now, but I'm only doing that because I'm showing this to you guys as an example. So I copy the name. We'll go ahead and paste the name. That way you don't have to type it out. It's right there. We'll go ahead and save it to my desktop. And now it's time for me to get the files. You can see there's the name of my session, Christina Aguilera. The name of the song is Your Body. Now we have to go back and import those files. So let's go back and import it. Now Shift-Command-I is the quick key. You can see I did the quick key down at the bottom there. If you don't remember the quick key, that's okay. You can find it underneath the File menu. File. Import, and we're going to go here to audio, and there you see there's the quick key that I use, Shift, Command, and I. It brings us to this window, which basically allows me to go look back through my Macintosh. We'll go back to my music folder, because I know that's where I stored it. I stored it in the artist remix files. There's the song there, Christina Aguilera, Your Body. And here are all the stems. Now notice how I select one stem here, the bass stem, it gives me information about it. It shows me it's a broadcast wave. The length of the file is 4 minutes, 5 seconds, 882 milliseconds. Gives me the file size, it's 41.37 megabytes. Shows me the bit depth and sample rate. But if you select multiple files, that information goes away. Also, if you select a file, you can actually audition the file. So we go to hit play down at the bottom here. So you can play the file there. If you want to actually zoom around through the file, maybe it's a 2-hour movie file. You probably don't want to have to actually listen to the entire thing. You can scroll up to the minute and seconds you want. Hit play. All right. So we're going to go ahead and select all the files. And then you have the option here of adding the files or copying them. Well, let me explain to you the difference between the two. Add them will actually just leave those original files in that folder that you just saw me go to. Whereas copy is going to make a brand new copy of these and attribute this new copy to my new Pro Tools session. So you basically want to get in the habit of using copy, not add. Yes, it's going to take up some more hard drive space, but it's worth it. That way I have the original files there intact. That way if I gum something up and I really mess up something in my Pro Tools session, not a big deal. I can go back and get those later on because I have the originals and I'm right now creating a copy of them. So we'll go ahead and we'll hit done. That way we copy them. You can see it added them to this right-hand column. We'll go ahead and hit done. Now, it defaults going back to your audio files folder, but look where the audio files folder is. It's exactly where it needs to be. It's inside the session folder for the session that we just created on my desktop. So yes, that's perfect. Leave it in the audio files folder. We're creating new copies. All right. Now, this will take a second here because it's got to basically change the file type because the original files, we just saw them, there were 16-bit files, and I created my session slightly differently. What did I create my session as? Do you guys remember? You saw me just do this. If you don't remember, it's okay too. I created my session as a 32-bit session, so it's actually changing the file type and making it match what my session is. Now, it's done trying to import it, but it's asking me where do I want to put these files. If I check off clip list, it's simply just going to put them over in this clips bin here. If I check off new track, which I've already got here, it's going to basically take the files. It's going to already add them to the clips bin, but it's also going to put them in a track, rename the track based off of the file name. So we're going to go ahead here and hit OK. Now all the files are in there. You're going to see the actual waveform start to render here any second. Pro Tools is doing its magic of finding out what the waveform should look like. Cool. Now we have the song. I'll go ahead and play the song back so you can get an idea of what the song sounds like. It's really cool. It's Christina Aguilera. Of course, she's incredible. Let's check it out. Let's take a listen. Soloed out the vocals here.
I don't need to know where you've been. All I need to know is you and no need for time
again. Hey, soloed out the drums real quick too, so.
Let's get wild again.
So we've got basically everything we need for her song. Now, what the lesson here that I want to impart on you guys that we're about to show you is, yeah, we showed you how to import. That's great. We got all the files inside of Pro Tools. That's excellent. We can actually probably start working on this. However, there's something that's not going to work with this, and it's not going to be really obvious right away for your first time dealing with Pro Tools, and that's going to be dealing with the grid itself and the tempo. Now, fortunately, they gave us tempo information about the song, but I want to pretend as though you were given this song and no one told you what tempo it was in. So that's going to be one of the first things you're going to have to figure out. And it's going to be because getting the grid to line up in any DAW is the most important part of anything I'm probably going to teach you guys this entire month. And it's not going to seem important here until I actually show you why that's important. The easiest way for me to do that is to hide all my tracks. Over here, we've got the tracks list. Clicking on any track will hide it. If I play it back, you'll still hear it. It's just hiding it from view. So let's hide all tracks except for the drums. And I'm going to use the drums as an example here because the drums are going to let you hear right away what is going to work and what's not going to work about this song. And to show that off, I'm also going to show you a feature which is basically using a click track. So if we go here to our tracks menu and we say, well, let's create a click track. So now I've got a click track. Now if I go to play this back, I'm going to turn my click track up so you can really hear this. You're going to hear this is going to sound like a train wreck. It's going to sound terrible immediately. And that's purposefully done. I want you to hear what's wrong and that way we know how to go back and fix it. So let's go ahead and play this back so you can hear what's going on in this track. It's not going to sound pretty, but again, I'm doing this for a reason. Okay, so obviously the tempo is incorrect. We don't have the correct tempo. Now, what I want to show you guys how to do is how to figure out the tempo in a song, even if the artist didn't include that tempo information, because that's going to be one of the more important features that I'm going to be able to teach you this entire month. And after I show you this, you're going to realize, okay, this is where the money's at. This is where the game's at. Because once you actually lock up the audio to your current session's tempo, I'll be able to take this apart and put it back together in a way that it wasn't originally created. Let me actually show you what it is I'm talking about. So let's actually zoom in on the drums a little bit. You can grab the track here, stretch it out. If we use our command and bracket keys, we can zoom into the waveform. Now, the reason I'm doing this is I actually want you guys to be able to see the waveform. So I want you to be able to see where these drum hits are. So we need to basically count out either one or two bars. So we'll need to play it back. Actually, let me do this too. Let's actually turn our click track off because he's going to get annoying. I just want to hear the raw audio by itself. And I'm going to use my arrow keys as well to make selections. So if you see selections happening, that's me hitting my up or down arrow keys. Your down arrow actually serves as the down position. Your up arrow will resolve it. So I'm just going to hit my up arrow along with the beat. Okay, so if I take a look at what I just did, we zoom in. I got the beginning. I use my back arrow. The back arrow shows me the front arrow shows you the beginning. Back arrow shows you the end. Now, I basically just kind of missed that. So I can use hold down shift and actually make that selection. Let's go back and actually show you what I'm talking about here. Let me back up a couple of steps here. Now, I'm kind of skipping some processes here, and some of the processes that I'm skipping that's probably about to go over your head is I haven't showed you guys the actual modes that we're using, and I haven't showed you the tools here either. I'm going to expect that you guys are going to go back and do your reading and watch the videos that actually deal with the modes and the tools. Without knowing these, you guys are going to be lost, so let me kind of explain to you what I'm doing. In slip mode, you can put your selector anywhere. You can make selections anywhere. I'm just clicking and dragging to make a selection. In shuffle mode, if I delete anything, notice when I delete it, everything shuffles down, which there'll be different reasons why you want to use different modes. If I'm in spot mode and I separate something, go ahead and separate that, and I go to try to move that, spot dialog says, well, where do you want that to go? So if I tell it, well, I want it to go to bar 7, beat 4. Hang on a second here. Bar 7, beat. Try that again. Bar 7, beat 4. You'll see it basically just relocate to that position. And then you've got grid mode. When grid mode is instantiated, if I try to move this, notice it wants to move to a specified grid value. Now, there's going to be reasons where, why you'd want to use different modes, and you will figure that out here pretty quickly as we go along. For right now, I'm going to use something called Tab to Transient. What Tab to Transient does, when I place my selector and I hit Tab, notice that it actually tabs. Sorry, let me turn that back on. When I use Tab to Transient, it will tab to the drum transient. It will actually automatically understand and see the transient. If I want to go back to previous transient, hold down Option and Tab, and there you go. So I'm just going to tab up until we get to that big drum beat there, and I actually want to make a selection of one bar. So I'm playing it back, and I'm hitting my up arrow key. And I pretty much nailed my selection here, but let's actually zoom in. We got the beginning, back end is slightly off. So I'm going to hold down Shift and Tab, and it'll automatically go up to the next drum transient. Now, what I'm really wanting to make sure is I'm wanting to make sure that I've got a nice perfect loop here. So we're going to listen to loop playback. Make sure that loop playback's on. And before I nail this perfectly, I'm actually going to make a mistake here intentionally so you guys can hear the difference. That way, basically, your head should nod along to the beat. If your head's nodding along to the beat, it should resolve itself perfectly. In this case, once your head's nodding along to the beat, you're going to find that there's going to be a hiccup at the end. We'll go ahead and try this example so you can hear it. That's because I was off by one beat. We'll go ahead and get that extra beat in there, and now we'll try nodding our head. One, two, three, one, two, three, four. So basically I've got two bars. We'll count it off again here at the beginning. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. So I know I've got two measures in there. The only problem is Pro Tools doesn't see that. Pro Tools sees that there's two measures, one beat, and 396 ticks. So basically Pro Tools right now is wrong. Pro Tools doesn't understand the tempo. So what I want to use is I want to use a feature called Identify Beat. And I want to tell Pro Tools, no, here's what it really should be. So if you go underneath your event menu, you go to Identify Beat, and you can see the quick key is really an easy one. Command I, We're going to go in and we'll say, well, this is the beginning of the song. So it starts off at bar one. And if it's 2 measures long, what should the end location be? This is a question going out for the entire class. So I know that my measures are 2 bars long. What should the end location be? I already figured out the beginning location is beat one. I'm sorry, bar one, beat one. But the end location, if we have 2 measures, the end location. Now, Corey had a thought there. It's actually beat nine. Yes, you're correct. But there are 4 beats per measure, correct? So 4 beats are in bar one. 4 beats are in bar two. We're actually talking about bars here, not beats. So then what should the end location be? Yeah, there we go. Bar three. So you're saying to yourself, well, why is it bar three? Well, let me go ahead and hit OK. You'll see the grid corrected itself. Let me go back and undo that. I'm going to create a new track so you guys can see a new track underneath. The new track kind of lets you see the grid a little bit, right? And so here is my selection originally. This I know to be the correct selection. In fact, I'm going to go ahead and heal that separation that I have. No, you don't have to see that. Okay, so this is the correct selection, but notice that the bars, the lines in Pro Tools do not match up. And this doesn't really look that impressive right now, but it's going to be impressive here in a moment. So when we used Command-I or Identify Beat, we said the beginning is 1 and the end is really 3. Notice the lines, these bars just lined up. And now you're saying, okay. Well, that's actually a really big deal. Because now if I change my grid location, notice what I can do. We'll put it in 16th notes. Notice I can go and select individual drum hits if I put myself in grid mode. Notice I can go and select individual drum hits. So if I wanted to create something like a drum roll of some kind, just duplicate it. Now listen to what I just did. We'll select from here to here. I just basically created a small stutter edit. Now, the reason I was able to do that so easily is because if I go and grab a little individual hit, notice in grid mode, it automatically locks to the beat. I could have actually maybe even consolidated this. So shift option 3, and then done a little fade out on it, and it's going to almost make it sound like a delay. And all I did was just do an audio edit. Let's listen to it. Oops, hang on a second here. Let me do a quick little edit here. Maybe when I select these, there we go. Or maybe we want a double hit to happen at the beginning. So we take the hit, double it over. Now when we play it back, it's still going to work out mathematically. Maybe we want to do some other kind of snazzy effect, or just take this one hit and put it randomly throughout the song. Put it there. Put it there. I'll put it there. I'll put it there. I'll put a couple of them here. And when we go and play this back, it's still going to work out. All I did, notice I didn't even listen to any of the edits. I just basically snagged a little piece of audio and put it all throughout this little small loop. Okay, so this is why lining up the grid in any DAW is the most important thing. Now that I've locked up that original drum performance, I can take it apart and put it back together in a way that it wasn't originally played or even created. So now that I've locked it up, now I've wielded the power of what this really can do. I tell you what, let's keep that one there for right now. Let's go to the next 2 bars here. Let's have some more fun with this. And this is pretty much all we're going to get to probably this evening because we're about to start to run out of time here. Let's take this kick and let's duplicate it again. I just made it a slightly different pattern here. But let's maybe roll our snare here. And I rolled the snare. We'll consolidate it, shift option 3. And we'll create a fade in instead of a fade out. Maybe we'll take a small section here and we'll reverse this section. So I'll go to audio suite, go to other, we'll go reverse it. Shoot, maybe we'll also reverse that hit. And maybe just take some of these other small hits and put them around here. So I'll separate it. And just start moving them into different locations. We'll put it there and there. Oh, I don't know. Why not there? What the heck? Why not there? And maybe even there, there, and there. So we'll go back and just play it. Now notice, oops, I missed one here somewhere. Notice I just basically placed it in little spots just around the track. Let's go back and listen to it. Okay, so what you just basically saw me do, let's actually do this. Let's get two bars of just the original performance there, and let's go back and let's let you hear the difference. So the first four bars you're going to listen to are the bars that I decided to gum it up and play with a little bit. The rest of it, there at the tail end, lets you hear what the original sounded like. So let's go back and play that so you can hear it. So locking it up is one of the most important features of any DAW. Now you just saw me do a bunch of little dance maneuvers, and so you're probably thinking to yourself, you know what, I'm never going to do that in rock and roll. Well, you might not do it throughout the whole song, but you might do it for a cool little section and maybe, I don't know, in the bridge section or as an intro or outro section. Imagine doing this to vocals. Here's where it gets really cool. So if I pop open Christina's vocals, in fact, let's go back and let's pull up her lead vocals. Now, I tell you what, I'm going to actually get rid of everything I just did by just basically pulling it back out to the original. What the heck? Let's just leave it for right now. If I go in, we can actually do very similar effects to Christina's vocals. Now, would you always want to do this? Maybe not, but I'm just going to give you guys some creative thought and some other ways that you could utilize locking up your grid inside of any DAW. For instance, let's just kind of listen to what she says in a section where it's just normal, all right? So let's take a two-bar section. Let's take a listen to what she says in this section.
Open the box. No key, I'm locked, and I won't open the box.
Open the box and
open the box. Don't need no key, I'm locked, and I won't
open the box. Don't need no key, I'm unlocked. So the cool thing is her vocals are very, very rhythmic. So what I could do is we could actually complement her vocals by creating a new track underneath it, new stereo audio track. And open, that part of open, if I were to try to introduce that, we would just go ahead and edit out the word open. And I would just take that and duplicate it, or maybe put it every other section here. Oops. It's going to create kind of a little stutter effect. Oops. There we go. So now if we go back and listen to what I just did, all I did was give kind of a little introduction to the word that she's already about to say anyways. I'm going to go ahead and consolidate that. Let's consolidate it in some dead space. We'll create a little fade in for that to happen. And then when you hear that part played back, did you notice how we basically just introduced that word that she was about to say? I think this one little section could have gone away there. We could have actually just had it happen like that. So this word, open the box, we just basically created a small little lead-in. And the reason I took that away was she was already saying something here. If we go back and undo it, it got a little bit cluttered. In other words, this little bit, you don't want to have her stepping on her own vocals. It just doesn't work. So I delete that out, create that little fade-in right there for her. And when she goes to say that word, it's going to stutter its way in. Oh, yeah. So open the box. Now, we could have also done maybe even a reverse section. So when she says, oh, yeah, well, how about that's a part that we probably could have worked in there. So, oh, yeah, I think this is where she says, oh, yeah. How about we actually just take that, edit it out, drop it down to a track below it, and even reverse that. Audio suite, other, reverse, render it, and then maybe drop ourselves down into 30-second notes and go in and actually edit out every other note. I'll get rid of that one, that one, that one, that one. You get the idea. We're now creating these stutter effects that she didn't originally ever do. But it's going to work out. Everything mathematically is going to work. And again, I'm just trying this off the cuff, so if this doesn't work, don't kill me. Let's give it a shot. Take what I find. Oh, yeah. Open the box. I didn't actually even really hear that. Let's go back and hear what I just did. It's kind of hard to hear it out and make it out. Yeah, it's kind of just a little stutter effect. You get the idea. All right. So listen, guys, I'm having a little bit too much fun, and I'm not going to – I don't want to get too carried away with this. One thing that I wanted to get to tonight was now that we have the tempo locked down, what we need to really go do is actually stencil out musically where the song structure happens. And – I didn't get a chance to show this to you guys tonight. That's okay. We'll actually pick this right back up next Monday night when we see you guys back after the holiday. And we're going to teach you guys how to create memory locations, because what I need to do now is actually get the song structure down and figure out. And look, you can kind of see it, the waveforms. We figure we got the intro section here. We know that she starts singing here. So verse one and two are happening through here. I can already see this is probably going to be chorus sections happening through there. Not really sure. But let's see. Well, basically, we go find her vocals. That's her background vocals happening there. So it looks like some background vocals are going to be happening during the chorus. I need to go grab the originals and listen to the actual vocals. But you get the idea. So we're going to pick back up with actually talking about the song sections and how to lay out the song sections. Because that way, when we start writing parts, we'll just be able to slide them over and pop them to where they need to go, because the grid is already laid out for the song itself. So cool. I tell you what, I'm going to come right back, guys. What it is, I actually have nature calling, so I'll be right back. Give me 5 minutes. I'm going to let the song play for a second, and I'll be right back to take your questions.
So open.
All right, guys, any questions you guys might have? We're pretty much done for the evening, but I want to give you guys enough time that if there's something that I did that went over your head, the only thing you really have to concern yourself with tonight is finding a song that you would be interested in remixing, making sure that you've got an established tempo. So in this case, we're able to use identified beat and get the track nailed down. However, there was a couple little glitches here that I didn't actually point out. We're actually off by about a 16th note throughout the entire song. I'm going to point this out more when we get into next week, but basically this week the only thing you've got to worry about doing is finding a song you want to remix, getting the files over into Pro Tools, and then if you want to get ahead of next work's week, the only thing that extra that you would need to do would be to understand how memory locations work and setting up memory locations. So creating memory locations and stenciling out where your song structure is, which we're going to do here together next week. But that's the only thing you guys really have to worry about for tonight is finding a song that has a definite established tempo, getting the files over into Pro Tools, and then making sure that your tempo lines up with the click track. So Corey's asking about Native Instruments Machine Studio. I have it. I've messed with it in the local music stores, and I've thought about maybe potentially investing in it. But quite honestly, I think most of what Machine can do, I'm already probably doing it inside of Pro Tools. So I have kind of looked at it. What was impressive is just the demos that are on Machine. So I don't know if that's something you already own, but the demos on Machine are incredible. Charles asks, is there a live class tomorrow, and how can I view the archive of this lecture class? Yes, there is a class tomorrow. However, tomorrow's class goes over an assignment. What we're doing right now is we're getting you started on your final project. So we're actually just getting your files, getting you to pick a song this week, get the files downloaded, get them imported into Pro Tools, and then make sure that your session's tempo lines up. Tomorrow's class, yes, there is a class. And both of these, by the way, will be archived, and you'll find the archives underneath your announcement section of your FSO dashboard. But tomorrow's class deals with an assignment that's not really actually due for a week later. So not that I wouldn't want you to go to Brad's class. It's going to be a great class, but it's going to center on your assignment and your assignment only. So your assignment will be an 8-minute screen capture asking you to do 10 different steps inside of Pro Tools, and he'll cover that in detail tomorrow evening. So yeah, any other questions you guys might have? I'm going to hang out here for the next 10, 15 minutes as long as you guys have questions. And then once we're done with questions, we'll go ahead and wrap for the night. Any other questions, guys? Yeah, someone's asking about the glitch for registering for tomorrow's class. And what I'm going to do is once we're done here, I'm going to email Brad, let him know that it's simply a link that needs to be updated, plus the actual date. So there's two small errors in the posted assignment. The reason this caught Brad off guard is typically his class, mine is Monday night, just like you guys attended this evening. His class doesn't usually happen until Thursday night. And so I don't think that he was... It just caught him a little off guard because he pushed it up several days. So, it shouldn't be for my class because I don't typically put a date on there so that I don't have to change it. So if that's the case, it could be because Brad sat in on my class. I'm not sure, but I'll go back and take a look at that. Chanel, what were you talking about as far as it's for my class as well? Are you talking about dates or the link itself? Because the link works just fine. You guys wouldn't be able to come hang out if the link didn't work right. Yeah, we're aware of that. And again, that's due to the dates for this class. Chanel, the dates for this class have actually been changed slightly due to your holiday week. And normally Brad has this class that you'll be attending tomorrow on Thursday. However, since it got moved forward, I think he just hasn't had time to go back and change those dates and times and or update the link. So please understand that he will update that. But it's a small glitch and it's easily fixable. Now, you were saying the same is for my class as well, and you may be correct, but I would find it hard to believe that everyone would make it to my class if the link wasn't working. So maybe there's something else you're talking about. It's hard to tell because we're dealing with a text conversation. So I'm not totally 100% sure what you're referring to. Yeah, not a big deal. That's okay. No problem. I totally understand if you had a sound issue. Does anybody else have any questions for tonight? Well, listen, guys, it sounds like you guys are already prepped and ready for Turkey Day. Glad you guys were able to come hang out this evening. I look forward to seeing you guys back. Next Monday night, we'll do it same bat time, same bat channel. And you guys have a really good holiday. Get some rest, too. Forget about this Pro Tools stuff for at least a couple days. We'll tackle it when I see you back next Monday night. All right, guys. Good night. Have a great evening.